Here they are, Depeche Mode.
Hi. Adam, Adrian, we met before, right?
Yes, yeah. We have just a few moments ago.
Yeah, I remember that.
This is the segment of the show we call Men in Black.
So I feel underdressed.
I got black shoes.
Do you walk around Essex like that?
I would.
I think you walked out, exactly.
But mostly with the boots, it's like little kids that are like, Mum, he's got red boots on.
Yeah,
and they're like, I know.
The point is, I really need them here now. So it's very nice. I'm so glad you've chosen them today. I mean, you've been doing TV shows like this for 37 years. Or maybe longer for... Is it 37 years you've been together?
We've been together for 37 years, yes.
In fact, one of the first TV shows in Sweden.
Like 1982 or something.
Something like that.
So
with Phil Collins.
With Phil Collins. I remember that.
We were supporting.
But what's the weirdest memory from a TV show? I asked this before we start.
Chickens, probably.
Yeah. Yeah, we had to carry chickens. It was a German TV.
And mid-80s.
We wanted to do well in Germany and we just did it.
What do you mean? What suggestion was that? Carrying chickens
in? The Germans.
What, they like that, do they?
Yeah.
What, that's the way to get through... They're carrying chickens, we love them.
It was a comedy programme.
Oh, I see, I see.
Right. I'm not sure about that, Mark.
They thought it was funny, us carrying
There was a whole farmyard scene, wasn't it?
It was.
There was, like, haystacks and... Then they suddenly gave us these chickens, and I was singing a song.
With the chicken?
I was holding the chicken, but...
I think you were.
Was I? Yeah. Oh, yeah. I would have done it. I'll do anything.
Don't try and get out of it.
I'll do anything, yeah.
When you meet these days, and you meet mostly for work, I understand, when you're working.
But it's a long time when we're working together.
Yes, but...
And we need time
apart.
But
you live, I mean, all over the world. You live in New York.
New York.
You live in Los Angeles.
Santa
Barbara, California. And you live here in London?
Yes.
But when you meet, is it like you fall intuitively fall into roles? You know what part to play in a way?
Yeah.
I mean, who's the boss?
We're a democracy.
We're a democracy, you know, much like the rest of the world. We're all very strong characters. So, you know, we have our things, and together we make what is Depeche Mode.
I'm very impressed because you
Do you write songs by yourself
so
and then show the band, or do you get together and jam?
Predominantly, no, we don't. We are not a jam band.
No.
No. It's
difficult, isn't it?
Like, sit in a room and play each other's stuff. Yeah.
Sequencer.
For the last, 15 years, 20 years, maybe we sit in a room longer, even when it was down to little cassettes. Martin would have written a few songs, maybe. We get together, whoever we're working with, whatever producer's going to be working on that record. And then that's the first time we really hear something.
And it's quite an exciting moment.
It's usually really revealing. It's very revealing. And you get, it's most of the time, to be honest, when Martin plays a few demos, there'll be a couple of songs where I just go, I'm in, because they're so good. And I want to sing them. And I already start thinking about how I'm going to sing them and how I'm going to perform them even. So that's taken years and years, but that's the way it works. And I've been lucky to I'm a bench player. Our manager doesn't like me saying that, but I've been only writing with the band for 15 years, which is nothing compared to how long we've been together.
And were you ever close to quitting? I mean, were you ever close to end this adventure?
What else are we going to do?
Yeah, well.
Nothing to fall back on.
We got a gig, you know. Like, we're not going, we didn't do that well at school, so. Well, they did.
Back to Tesco's or something?
Yeah, back to. I'm sacking shells in Tesco's.
But it's been 37 years. You must have been close
We had one period of our career, which is well documented, when all three of us went through a pretty rough patch. But when you say close to quitting...
For about 10 years, yeah, that was that. That was 10 years. Sort of lost period.
Yes, but that was because of drugs and alcohol and
predominantly, I mean, yeah.
We were trying our best not to quit, but we were kind of like losing our way a bit.
The drugs and the alcohol were way more important than the music at that point.
Especially for you, wasn't it?
I mean, well, we all had our things, but you know, mine was kind of out there. Oh. Yeah.
Was it like this in the show No Dancing?
What, the 6 months that of my pop career?
I've been
Googling this. Oh, here we go. I'll tell you what, this was right. It was
nice
two
shirt,
of us.
By the way.
We wrote a few songs. Thanks. We did a demo. We got signed immediately. Cool. We put out a single, didn't make it. Put another single, got a bit closer, but didn't make it. They dropped us. That was it.
Thank God, because Ricky Gervais, I mean, right?
We wouldn't have Ricky Gervais.
I mean, you have carried me through many years. Oh, thank you.
Seriously.
Thank you, man.
Seriously, I want to say thanks for that. I laughed myself. Stupid.
No, you eventually find something you're good at. It just took me... It took me 37 years to find something I was good at.
The fact that you're going... I mean, the song we're going to hear, it's called Where's the Revolution? And it's more political in a way than much of your material. Was that a conscious thing that you chose now to be more political because perhaps the times are more political?
Everyone's more political now.
I mean, artists have got, you know, it's just Martin wrote the song and he's very conscious about what's going on around him. Mm. You can't not.
I mean, wasn't political till 6 months ago.
Right.
Now it's all I talk about. Mm. Because of what's happened,
it's really strange
true.
Times.
Yeah. Yeah. True.
But it's the album's called Spirit, and really, and the songs are all reflect on where's humanity? What's happening? Where do we care anymore? So I mean that's broad, but
that word's come up so much tonight, and it's the name of my new tour.
Good one.
I've already got tickets.
I mean, it's a bit serious, but, yeah. You know, look, music, you know, quite often reflects... I mean, I grew up mostly listening to David Bowie, and Martin's a big Bowie fan as well, and we, you know, he was like the soundtrack to our lives, you know. It was kind of... you know, he represented something that we felt was similar to the way we felt, if that makes any sense. And music always carried me through so much stuff, and still does. Mm.
I don't know if that makes any sense.
You were friendly with him, or...?
Yeah, I can't believe it. He was a hero of mine growing up, and then I met him, and so we became friends, and, yeah, he was just a normal bloke. It's funny, because the first time I met him, he didn't know who I was. It was at a... I was newly famous after The Office, and I went to one of those VIP things where he played. And afterwards, we're in the green room, and the then Director General bounced up to me and said, "You're a huge Bowie fan, aren't you?" He went, "Come and meet him."
Oh, no.
I went, "Oh, no." Went, "Come on," right? So it was me and my girlfriend, and as we were going there, he went, "Salman." Salman Rushdie joined us, right? So it's me and my girlfriend, Salman Rushdie, Greg Dyke. It goes down, David Bowie's, it went, "Oh, hello," like that. And so this is where he went, "Hello, nice to meet you." And that was it. Right, it's funny, the next day in the pub, my mate said, "What did you do last night?" I went, "Nothing." What did you say? And then I got an email like a week later, and it just said, someone must have said, "Oh, that's the bloke who did The Office," and given him a DVD or something. And suddenly I get an email from David Bowie. I don't know how he did it, but he's David Bowie, he can get your email. Right?
Yeah.
And it just said...
Aliens.
Exactly. Yeah, he was plugged in. He knew everything. Right? And they just said, "I watched, I laughed, what do I do now?" And we sort of became pen pals, and then he did extras and invited me to...
He actually played a cameo in your...
Well, you guys wrote a song
extras.
Together.
Yeah.
They wrote a song together.
Yeah. Yeah, it was amazing. It was incredible. But he was a normal bloke.
That was an amazing piece of comedy.
It was great. So, So when I said to do it, I said, the idea is that I'm this guy and I meet you and you sing this assaulting song. I did the lyrics and I sent him the lyrics and I said, do the music, right? And I called him up and I said, you get the lyrics? He went, yeah. I said, give us something like retro, like, you know, Life on Mars. He went, oh, yeah, I'll knock off a quick fucking Life on Mars.
He did, though. He's put the music in his mouth, you know, yeah. He did it. He fucking did it.
Yeah.
That was so good. Have you seen that?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's the lyrics are they are really offensive, but it's towards you.
Well, so, harsh.
I mean,
yeah.
And he's so polite when he sings them.
His last live appearance was inviting me on stage at Madison Square Garden, and he just walked out. I didn't know he was there, and he walked out. Had a little harmonica, went. Chubby little loser.
The crowd went mental.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh right. Well.
You're gonna do Where's the Revolution for us now, and. Going a little more political is also a risk. I mean, the thing is that you've had recently you've had a fan that you didn't appreciate the leader of the alt-right mm-hmm. American alt-right, mm-hmm. and he claimed that you were their number one mm-hmm. band in a way. What was your immediate reaction to that news?
Oh, I can't say it on TV, can I? It started with C and ended with T.
And it's an English very short word.
Yeah.
Okay, so I take it you didn't appreciate it.
Look, this is a dangerous guy. He's like, you know, he's highly educated. You know, he's...
Richard Spencer.
Yeah. I don't say his name, really, but...
Well, he's not here to defend himself,
you know,
I should say that.
They're the most dangerous kind of, like, idiots, aren't they? People actually listen to him.
Anyway...
Yeah, I went a bit...
You're going to do it. No, but I mean, it's in these days and ages, it's interesting to actually take the chance to be political, and the fact that you do that will create.
Martin says it the best. Like, ultimately, we're entertainers, and that's what we do, and we want to bring joy and make people feel good, and that's what we're going to do. We're going out on this tour, and we see it, we feel it every night.
Your tour is starting in Stockholm. It's opening in Stockholm in May.
Yes.
And you're very much welcome there. But now you're going to do a song on our stage, and we look forward to that.
Please thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Walk off properly.
Thanks.
We'll see you later.
Thank you.